Hello, welcome, greetings. Thank you so much for joining me this evening for the next 30 minutes or so. I'm Danny Gill. Maybe you've seen me, maybe I've seen you, but it's nice to virtually see you all tonight. Actually, I'm just staring down the lens of a camera, so hopefully you guys see and hear me okay. So for the next 30 minutes or so, we're gonna talk about ways that you can go about learning solos and how you can use what you learn from those solos in your own playing. I'm gonna talk about five different ways. So the first tip is gonna be to learn a lick from a solo slowly and then work it up to speed. Seems pretty obvious, but we'll talk about some ways you can go about doing that. The second tip is gonna be to play a lick over an entire song, just kind of over and over and see where it fits throughout a track. The third tip is gonna be to transpose a lick to other keys so that it's more useful. You know, if you have a lick in a minor key, there's ways to make it work in a major key. So we'll take a look at that. The fourth tip is to turn a lick into an exercise. Gonna do some arpeggios there. We'll talk about that. And the fifth and final tip would be to apply different rhythms to a phrase. So you have a group of notes. If you don't always play it with the same rhythm, it can sound radically different, but with the same notes. Okay, so let's get to it. I was jamming over a kind of a slower version of the Mr. Crowley solo, which has just a super useful, all-purpose, one-size-fits-all, works anywhere lick that you may recognize. It goes like this. And it's connected with. So we're just gonna take a little piece of that, but let's see how we can learn that lick slowly. So I'm gonna go to the Lick Library website. I'm sure you're familiar with the Lick Library website. And I'm gonna go to a Mr. Crowley guitar lesson. And you'll probably recognize this guitar. So I'm gonna do a little screen share here. My good friend Stuart is gonna help me out with that. And we'll take a look at a way you can go about learning a lick and just do it slowly and repetitively. Okay, here we go. So, if we're all set with this stream and we got the screen share happening, here's the Mr. Crowley main guitar solo. Let's see what's happening. We're buffering.
You want to keep up with Randy Rhodes? Starts off with some pentatonic runs, some classic pentatonic runs, just played really fast. And it moves into some other scales, blues scale, a little bit of harmonic minor, but we're going to start with this phrase.
Okay, so there's a lick. That's pretty quick, and I want to learn it slower. So what I'm going to do is go over to this looper function. Maybe you've seen this before, maybe not. But in all the Lick Library songs, you can start a loop at a certain spot and end it at a certain spot. We'll start at A, I'll press B when I'm done, and it will just loop until I hit these buttons again, and then it will stop. So let's try that out.
Okay, so let's break that down. First lick goes like this. This is going to be a bend from 12 on the G string, grab 10 on the B, 10 on the high E, and then pull off 13, 10 on the B string.
That's okay, so I'm just going to repeat that over and over again.
Like
so I
this.
Put this loop on.
This is going to be a bend from 12 on the G string, grab 10 on the B, 10 on the high E, and then pull off 13, 10 on the B string. That's going to be like this. This is going to be a bend from 12 on the G string, grab 10 on the B, 10 on the high E, and then pull off 13, 10 on the B string.
Okay, so you get the idea with that. Now, another thing that I can do, I can just press this to get out of the loop. But let's say that that's still going a little too fast for me. I can hit this cogwheel here. This tells me the quality that I'm seeing it back at. We can go to the clock up here, playback speed, and I can slow it down. Let's say we go to 3/4. And I can still keep this loop on. So now it's gonna loop at 3/4. So I just wanna do it nice and slow over and over again, a million times.
That. Like this. This is gonna be a bend from 12 on the G string, grab 10 on the B, 10 on the high E, and then pull off 13, 10 on the B string.
That's. Okay, so I'm gonna get out of the loop here.
Like this.
And we can stop the screen share. Thank you, Stu. We'll stop the screen share. Hopefully you guys can see me again. So I've got that lick. So what do I do with this now? I keep trying to do that just over and over again. And maybe that's a real easy lick for you to do, I don't know. But if you're having trouble with it, you know, you can break it down, figure out, okay, I want to bend with my ring finger. That's what I would recommend. Middle finger behind there. Always want to have strength when I push the string. You notice I have my first finger kind of covering the top two strings, so I don't have to do a bunch of unnecessary jumping. So there's a little bit of technique there. I'm picking all of this, and then I'm going to pull off here. Some of you may need to work with your little finger. This could be a good way to go. And I'm back. And that lick will work just really like anywhere, any song. In the context of Mr. Crowley, you could recognize it as the Mr. Crowley lick, but I mean, that's just a blues phrase that's been used endlessly. So it's kind of public domain stuff. You can take that and you can just use it anywhere, anytime. The next lick in the song went like this, which is a group of three sequence. This is something that you should be familiar with as well, doing sequences with scales. So this is something just like practicing scales up and down. You should practice sequences so that you can use the sequences hopefully in a musical context so they don't just sound like exercises. But once again, this is a super common one, super useful. I'm just taking the D minor pentatonic scale, which is this. And then I'm just doing three notes down. Get a little cleaner sound here. And again, three notes down from the next note. Three notes from the next note. From the next note. You can go down or back up. And then once I get the hang of those, then I'll put on this backing track. And the backing track that I'm using right now is from a lesson package called Randy Rhoads, The Solos. And this is a very cool lesson package because what it does is it goes through just classic solos. It's like Mr. Crowley, and it gives it, let me go back to where you can see me. It gives you these backing tracks and the solos demonstrated slow, medium, and then up to tempo. So you get backing tracks at each of those tempos. So sometimes when you're using a piece of software, it can sound a little glitchy when you slow things down. These were recorded originally at that slower tempo. So that backing track, just to listen to it, this was the medium tempo one. So I'll try and just play some of those licks. So I'll just stop there. I can do that lick and I can just rest. I don't have to continuously do it. I don't have to start off shredding, doing it 20 times in a row. You can start off just doing it once, get the hang of it, listen to how it sounds, and it can sound great slow as well with some pause in between. So maybe I'll even listen to the track before I start. Okay, I kind of got the. Okay. I'm doing a lot of stop starting because I'm getting excited about all these ideas. So with that lick, you may have noticed I didn't play it exactly the same every time. This is something I was going to talk about a little bit later, but let's get right into it now. You don't always have to do the same rhythm. If you break up the rhythms, maybe you hold one of the notes longer, at one point than you do if you're just doing the notes back to back. You can create some different rhythms, or if you start on a different part, like if you count and go 1, 2, 3, 4. That could sound different than if I start on 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. They can sound really different how they're affecting the backing track or the chord progression underneath. So there's a ton of stuff you can get out of that. One simple lick can go a really long way. And it's always good to repeat yourself. That's your mantra for the evening. Repeat yourself, because it's very effective. If you keep playing something over and over again, the audience will understand what it is that you're saying, what you're playing, and they'll get into it. They'll go, huh, okay, he's got something. It's like throwing out a line. All right, I caught one. I caught a lick. I'm doing it. And people can really relate to that. So let's try it again. That lick. Different rhythm. Another thing to think about is, yeah, just holding one of the notes longer or shorter, whatever the case may be, and they can sound quite a bit different as well. Take part of it. All right, so far so good. So that leads to another idea, and that is just playing a lick over an entire track. So you could put on Mr. Crowley, and you could play that lick pretty much through the whole song as well. So I've just kind of been demonstrating it with that solo section, but of course you can just continuously do that. You can take a lick from any song, whatever your favorite licks are, and you should have a bunch of these. These kind of just, I call them public domain licks, like licks that work anytime, anywhere. You just can pull out of your pocket and you can tweak them to make them fit within the track. You should have a bunch of them. You should have at least 10 just kind of go-to licks that are always gonna work. So far, so good. So I'll just do that one more time, and this will just be a demonstration of playing the same lick. I've been kind of applying the lick and then going off a little bit just because it's a fun thing to do, but I'll stick with the lick. And I haven't done the group of three, so this time I'll do the group of three. So I need to think of the rhythm. Da 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 da. Bottom in front of me, front over bottom. We'll be right back. Wah-wah, tons of overdrive. My sound is probably going, no noise gate. I think it's your turn now. I've been playing a lot of notes. Take that lick or any lick that you know very well and see if you can apply it over the backing track. I assume you guys have your guitars with you. Whether you're plugged in or not, I am just gonna run the backing track and it's your turn. Are you ready? Let's do it. Here we go. Let me give you a little bit of a run in so you can hear the count. It should work. It's all you. How did that work out? I wish I could hear you. Hopefully it worked out great. Let's take the same lick and let's see how it can sound in a different context. So what if we have a backing track that's in a major key? I'm gonna take this Journey song. Oh, I'll turn off the delay a little bit. Any way you want it, the chords are. So that's going to be in G major. The chords are G, D, and E minor. It's centered around G major. You'd say the song is in G major. So how do I apply that lick that I just learned in a major key? It's actually quite simple. That was in D minor. That could also have been considered in F major. If we're playing a song in F major, flats. If we were playing some kind of song in F major, that D minor lick would have worked perfectly. We wouldn't have had to have switched out at all. If we want to play in G major, same as E minor, we can just take that lick and move it up into this 12th position here, kind of between the 12th and the 15th fret. So you could consider this G major pentatonic, or you can also call it E minor pentatonic. In this case, we'll call it G major pentatonic. We're probably gonna wanna emphasize G a little more than E, but you know, it's all good, it's all legal. So here's the backing track. Let's kind of listen to it and see what we can do. Okay, so let's say we try that group of three. I'll stop there for a second. So I was trying to do that same lick, and I did the group of three, and it sounds nothing like Mr. Crowley. I'm gonna go a little further along in the track. Yeah. All right. That's tons of fun. I'm getting a little carried away here just because I think it's really cool. I'm doing the exact same thing. So I don't have to learn a whole bunch of new things. I can do the same old tricks, and I think they work quite well. That was the Mr. Crowley lick, and it'll work over anything. And I just did it transposed to G major. So another very cool thing. So play the licks slowly. Make sure your technique is happening so that you can get them smoothly. You have to memorize them. You can't be looking at the page. So as soon as possible, get the notes off the page, and you are good to go. So that's transposing the lick to other keys. The other tip is to turn a lick into an exercise. So what do I mean by that? Well, this one's a little more complex. This could be possibly one of the last things that we talk about, but if you take an idea such as, let's say you're doing Hotel California, you know, there's a big, long, arpeggiated section at the end. You've got that B minor, the F sharp, A, E, G, D, E minor, F sharp major. Okay, so how can you get an exercise out of that? How can you get the most out of actually going through the trouble of learning that and apply it to your own playing? Because you don't want all these things that you go through, all the trouble to learn, to just be isolated. So what you need to do is figure out, what is that first arpeggio? I said it's B minor. I gave away the answer. Why is it B minor? Well, it's B minor because there's your B, and it's a minor shape. You have those three notes that make up a minor chord, which makes it an arpeggio. B, D, F sharp. Got a lot of delay on there. Okay, the next one, that was F sharp. You're actually, you've got the flatted seven, you've got the fifth, you've got the major third. It was from an F sharp seven. And then we went from the F sharp, we went down to an A. So that A, that's a major right there. That makes it A major. So just remember the shape. And then it continues on other major shapes. Here's an E major shape. There's the E. So the moral of the story is know your arpeggios, know where the root notes are, know whether they're major, minor, or perhaps dominant seven, and those three will take you very far. So if I try and apply that with another song or another chord progression, which I'm going to do right now, I'm just going to outline major and minor shapes. But just to review, because I know I'm talking really pretty fast. This is a minor shape. There's your root note. This is a major shape. There's your root note. Here's also a major shape. But there's the root note. Here's a minor shape. There's the root note. Here's a major shape. There's the root note. Okay, you got to know all these things. There's lots of info on Lick Library if you're interested. I have a one lesson called Shredding with Arpeggios, and I take you through just the inversion so you can get familiar with how to play arpeggios. And often, instead of doing them like on all six strings and super uber shred, I try and put it in a context that's a little more user-friendly. Sometimes these big ones, they can sound very cool, but it can be hard to squeeze them in. Okay, so enough talk. Let's rock. Here's my backing track. I'll let you hear the backing track first. Okay, I'm just gonna follow those chords. Well, I'll play the rhythm for you one time, so you can see what I'm doing. Okay, here I go, arpeggios. We'll be right back. Yeah. I'm back. So there it was. I took that Hotel California song. I learned those arpeggios. It's a song I've played for a while, and that's kind of a mandatory rock guitar player thing that everybody has to know. So I learned those arpeggios, but instead of just putting my fingers mindlessly in place, I thought about what arpeggio I was playing, how it related to the chord, so that you can take that, put it into another song. Simple as that. And then, of course, you know, the technique is involved, and you gotta, the more you do it, the quicker and more natural it becomes. But let me just show you. I did this F sharp minor. Turn off that delay. And then I did D major, or let's see, yes, I did F sharp minor, D major. So the F sharp minor is there, the D, there's the D. B, there's the B, it's a major. To G, there's the G root note. Back to F sharp minor. E major. Up to A. And up to B. Simple as that. Yeah! Woo! So, what's happening? Is it possible to do some questions, some what's up? If you guys want to ask me anything, please. Now might be the time. If not, I will just, I will roll on. I will do a little jam out. Hey, I recommended a JS. Did it work? Oh my, back in 79, are you serious? 79? This is aging me tremendously. Woo! That would be 1 year after Van Halen. I relate everything to when Van Halen 1 came out. So that's one VH, 1 year after Van Halen. What about transcribing? Transcribing is always great because these licks that I'm doing are kind of pentatonic-y rock licks. And if you're interested in other styles, if you want to get a, you know, you want to play like a jazz kind of thing, you need to transcribe. You need to learn a few handy licks in that style that you can apply to your playing. And if you write these licks down, you know, you can use, when I learn things, I often use the amazing slow downer. That way I can pitch it in different keys and I can slow it down. I go slow, I write things down, and so I have tons of licks that I write down. I usually write them down by hand and then put them on Guitar Pro or something like that so they're saved on the computer. But transcribing is a great way to develop your ears and get some licks under your fingers, especially if you're looking for licks in other styles to expand your playing. Stretching. What tips for stretching? It may sound like a silly one, but warm up. It's there's no replacing that. You cannot do, like just when I turned on the camera here at the beginning, I did this. Which is definitely not something you would want to do first thing in the morning before you've had your coffee, before you've gotten up and got your blood circulating and you've warmed up on the guitar. I still go through warm-ups because that makes me able to play stuff like that at the end of the day. If I just started playing right away, I would burn out if I just played in the morning, especially because I play a lot of hours every day. It doesn't mean I'm always practicing and improving necessarily, but I am playing a lot. I got my hands on the guitar a lot during the day. So if I don't warm up, I just get fatigued quicker. So warm up slow. I've talked a lot about warm-up exercises in the past. There's lots of stuff on Lick Library for warming up. I've got three lesson packages called Guitar Aerobics, and it goes through just a whole bunch of things that I still do to this day for warming up. So that's the best. And it doesn't mean that you warm up for an hour, 10 minutes. If you have a 10-minute warm-up, you're good. All right. Well, hey, thank you so much for joining me this evening. I'll do a little jam in F sharp on out, and I will say, yeah, thanks again. It's been really fun. So I hope you guys will join me next time, whenever that might be. So thank you, Stu. Thank you, Lick Library, and I will jam out.